Those of you that have not trained with me before, can you raise your hand if you've ever taught a martial art or trained in a martial arts of any kind, karate, taekwondo? Okay, cool. Well, if you haven't had any experience, if you have experience, great. And I don't want to change anything that you already know. I just want to make it add to it. So you can still work from your same stance, you can do the same kind of footwork, but maybe just adding a few tricks that I haven't put you here. And for those of you who have never taken any kind of martial arts, good job, first of all, for making the effort to learn it. I think, honestly, learning how to defend yourself physically is just kind of basic knowledge, basic information. You know, it's, in my opinion, it's like if you live in a world where there are cars and you need a car to drive around, you can get away with maybe taking the bus or taking a taxi all the time, but in the end, it just makes sense that you have to learn how to drive the car. So hopefully, you will never have to defend yourself or defend somebody that you love, but it is a thing that it's just a common sense requirement that you know how to either protect yourself or you know how to protect other people. Not that you're not required to be the best fighter on the planet, but you're required to at least have an understanding that there is this human body. There are things, weapons that you have naturally, weapons that you have on your body, and there are ways that you can affect those weapons against someone else, and there are weak points, which will give you an advantage. So the good news for you is that most people don't even know that. So what I'm hoping to do today, and just in a little bit of time that we have, is first teach you all a few things that you can use right away, so that you can leave here already having tools at your disposal that you can work with, that you can use to defend yourself. And also, I will hope to show you some kind of training exercises, more mental training exercises, that if you do practice on your own, you'll be able to kind of grow and develop something, you know, more substantial. So we'll give you, how do I say this? I'm going to give you all some flowers today that you have, but I'm also going to plant some seeds today. But hopefully, if you water those seeds, they will grow and then you will have something good. I'm speaking metaphorically, I'm not actually giving you flowers. So just to give you a really quick history of me, I'm from Ukraine originally. I was just speaking to Cecile about it. I tried to learn French at some point, but I kind of abandoned that try, but maybe at some point I will try again. Since I'm a foreigner and some of you are foreigners as well, if there is something that I say that doesn't make sense, please just raise your hand. I won't be offended. Don't worry about interrupting me. So what we're going to learn first, and it's something that's very important for you to understand, it's always an advantage to be bigger, to be stronger, to be heavier. It's always an advantage to be more aggressive. But it doesn't mean that you have a disadvantage if you're a smaller person. You have just as much of an opportunity to defend yourself as you do, as your attacker does to attack you. It's really, like, it's a common sense thing. But I want you to understand what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to be discussing techniques that have to work against someone who is bigger than you, who is heavier than you, who is stronger than you. So you're going to have to learn techniques. Hello, just have a seat when you're ready. So the techniques that I'm going to show you are going to be a little bit more like violent, a little bit more maybe brutal, because let's just kind of skip to the far. How do you make someone who is attacking you completely abandon the thought of attacking you and try to run away? You have to create a kind of pain and panic in them that they won't even be thinking. They will just instinctively be trying to escape. And so think to this way. Have you ever, like, if you're cooking something or you're helping somebody cook and you touch a hot stove and immediately you just have that reaction pulling away, right? You kind of been there. Now imagine if you touch the hot stove and for some reason you can't pull it away, right? It's just there and you can't get away. Can you imagine, like, how much panic you will have, like how much fear, how much like frenzy? So that's the kind of feeling that you want to create in your attacker for them to really abandon the thought of hurting you, right? Because these people are not looking for a difficult challenge. They're not looking for an opponent. If they wanted to, they could go be a fighter or something. But they're looking for somebody who they can maybe surprise, scare, who maybe if you're just so unaware of what to do or what's happening that you kind of freeze up and you give them basically an opportunity to then or just hurt you or take something from you or hurt somebody you love. So if they find all of a sudden that no, this is not just a challenge, this is a dangerous situation for them, this is a potentially deadly situation for them, they will most likely abandon the thought of attacking you. They will run away or go for somebody else. But in reality, regardless of what their intention is, there are very simple, or not simple, but they're very clear steps to winning in a violent confrontation. Now, before I go on, I want to give you just some history of me. So I grew up studying Sambo, which is Eastern European. Do you know, like, the Ultimate Fighting Championship? You all know what UFC is? So the sport is mixed martial arts. It's punching, kicking, it's wrestling, it's throwing, it's choking, that's all. So before it was mixed martial arts, it was Sambo back in Eastern Europe and in Russia. I grew up doing that, but I also achieved a black belt in Aikido, which is a Japanese style, Hapkido, which is a Korean style. And then when I graduated high school, I went into the United States Marines, and I was with the Special Security Forces, which is kind of small teams operations, but I also became a close quarter battle instructor, basically a close fighting instructor for the United States Marines as well. Since leaving the Marines, I have been competing nationally and internationally in boxing, kickboxing, and mixed martial arts. But I've also, for about the past 15 years, I've been teaching seminars up and down the East Coast in America, not just for ladies, but also for police officers, for federal agents, and for military contractors, which is just kind of like, you know, it's kind of like the military, but it's just for different companies. But the steps, the mental steps that I teach have always been the same. So what I'm going to teach to you all, the way to understand a violent conflict, is the same method that I would teach if you were, say, the FBI, or CIA, or military. The difference, and this is the advantage, is that when I train, say, police officers, or when I train Secret Service, there are laws against them doing specific techniques. You know, if you're a police officer, you can't use deadly force or techniques or moves on somebody unless you feel like your life is in danger, right? So for them, a police officer has to do a lot of explaining if they really injure somebody badly, because they're supposed to neutralize, not eliminate, you know. For you ladies, there are no rules blocking you from doing whatever you need to do to beat your attacker. So again, I say this to kind of mentally prepare you for the idea that you're going to learn how to attack people's eyes, we're going to learn how to break their knees, we're going to learn how to maybe knock them unconscious, maybe put them in a situation where they might die. So it's something that you have to take seriously, yes, and it's something that you have to understand that you're learning this because I don't want you to, how do I say it, it's not a game. Right, so I'm here for a very serious purpose, and that's to tell you all that if you are in a violent situation, it could be a deadly situation. And the problem is that if you just hope for the best, it doesn't work out. If you're abducted, and if you let yourself be transported, if you let your abductor transport you from one location to another location, your chances of surviving drop by 70%. There are things that are very unfortunate about this world, and I don't want you all to leave today paranoid or scared or worried that everybody's, because that's not what we want to do. You want to still enjoy your life, but you want to build the kind of awareness that makes you less of a target. You know, when we talk about the attacker, they're going to look for someone who is not going to give them a challenge. You want to already be aware, mentally, physically aware, that even as you're walking, they're going to see you and they're going to think, she's not an easy target. Maybe I don't mess with her. And it starts with the mind, mental training. But just for the last kind of example that I want to give, as far as the, you know, against a stronger attacker. You know what a pit bull is, the pit bull dog, right? So there is a misunderstanding that they have a very hard bite. Pit bulls bite hard, but a golden retriever actually has a stronger bite. German Shepherd has a stronger bite. What makes a pit bull dangerous is if they bite on here and they're really in fight mode, they really don't feel pain. So if the pit bull is biting like this and you're shaking them and you're hitting them and you're kicking them, they don't necessarily have to let go. But, now it's going to be gross, but if you take your thumb and you dig it into the pit bull's eyeball, gross, right? But they will stop. you understand? So even the strongest, scariest kind of monster that is attacking you, they still have an opportunity, there's still a chances, they still have weaknesses on them that you, even a more petite lady with not so much strength, you can affect. Now, will what we learned today completely protect you? No, it's your responsibility to develop and to be prepared and to work with, but you will have at least an understanding. You'll have at least some tools to start with, and then I really encourage you all to continue learning more things on your own. But when I talked about, I've trained military, I've trained Secret Service, and I've trained police, and I've trained ladies, so the steps are always the same to winning a violent confrontation. And just so you understand, it's the same steps that your attacker has to follow in order to be successful. So, step one, surprise, right? This is their biggest advantage against you. If you're walking with headphones on, and you're looking at your cell phone, and you're outside, it's easy to surprise you, right? Not even that, but even like a confusing thing, like imagine, it's kind of silly, but imagine if you and I are walking, crossing the path, you know, and you don't know me, I don't know you, and you smile and you say, good morning, and I grab you and I say, stop lying. For a second, just right now, for a second you kind of go, what? Like the wheels almost stop spinning in your head. But that's enough to confuse you to where you're vulnerable at that moment. You're confused, you're surprised. You understand what I mean? So not being surprised in the first place is an advantage. But imagine, for example, if you're caught and you're up against the wall and you're in danger now, and you think, you have to say, okay, you know, calm down, you're in control, calm down, calm down, and bang, you go right for their eyes. That's your surprise. Do you understand? So step one is surprise. Get the drop on them. Even if they have accosted you, and now if you're the one who's in danger, you still have an opportunity to look for that opening where they're unaware to surprise them. Step number two is speed. You gotta learn to work fast. That doesn't mean rush through the technique and cut corners and don't do everything correctly, just so you, it means that you have to practice and practice and practice until you can do it correctly and quickly. We have a kind of a saying in the military when you're learning something, slow is smooth, smooth is fast. What that means is that you have to practice slowly enough to where you can become aware of all the little details of a motion, of a technique, of a combination. And then as you get smooth in it, then eventually when you practice more and more and more, you can go quicker and quicker and quicker without missing any small details. Does that make sense? So step one is surprise, step two is speed, step three, it's called violence of action. What violence of action means is that you have to keep damaging the opponent over and over in very effective, hardcore kind of ways until the threat is eliminated or until you have an opportunity to run away. Do you know the term fight or flight? Have you heard of that before? Like taken psychology before? So it's that instinct in us and in animals where something happens, you're attacked or something is surprised. Someone is, I'm sorry, when the pollen comes out and people have allergies, for me it's hiccups. I spent the hiccup a lot as an allergic reaction, so forgive me if that happens. Where it's like a natural reaction. You either fight back right away or you escape right away. So I'm here to tell you that fight or flight, to fight back or to run away, either is a good opportunity, either is a good choice. There's no problem in running away. You have to just make sure that you are able to run away. First of all, being able to run is something you could start practicing on right now. Even in the military, so when we did like military training in the Marines, we had to be strong because basically you can be in really good shape and all this stuff. If you cannot pick your friend up and put them on your shoulder and get away with them, or if you cannot pick up, you know, ammunition, or so that's one thing. But two, you have to be good at running. And why? Because you have to be good at running away from. So practicing being good at running, and not just good at running, but being able to run fast without tripping over something. Just having that basic fitness and coordination is something that's just gonna be important for you to surviving. So that's something that you can practice on the jungle gym, on the playground, to run up something, to slide down something, to go sideways here. Those little things of coordination basically means start paying closer attention in gym class, because you need a body. And maybe, what if it's not somebody attacking you? What if it's an earthquake or something? Or what if it's a storm? Or what if it's something where you just have to get to safety quickly? So, okay, let's kind of put that off to the side, and let's understand, how do we need to think first to not be a target? Again, we didn't want, like I said, we don't want to be paranoid when we leave here. I don't want you looking over your shoulder all the time because you're worried about the threat. But we do want to use our brain and program our brain so that it will start to work automatically for us and look for danger. This is something that I, if you've taken the seminars with me before, you've heard me say this before, and it's worth repeating. So this is something you can start right now. As soon as you walk out of here, you could say, for the rest of the day, I'm going to keep an eye out for someone wearing a yellow sweater. Or for the rest of the day, I'm going to, starting now. For the rest of the day, I'm going to keep an eye out for somebody wearing a red hat. Or I'm going to look for somebody wearing glasses. So what does that do? That teaches you a couple things. First, it teaches you to look around. Yeah? Second, it teaches you to look for something specific. And third, and this is the most important part, if I look, if I say, okay, I'm going to look for somebody wearing a red hat, and I see, okay, no red hats, I don't have to worry about you all anymore. So it teaches your brain to identify, to assess, and then to discard if it's not important to you. Why is this important? Because eventually you will practice, and by the way, 2 weeks. If you're looking to make it a good habit, 2 weeks. If you need to remind yourself, you know, to stay aware, you can maybe write something on your hand, or write like red hat or something like that. And every time you see it, it's like, oh, okay, I gotta pay attention to somebody wearing a red hat. You practice this for about 2 weeks, what's going to happen is that eventually you're going to walk into a restaurant or into a classroom or something, and you can be just scan and then just be aware of it. And the second thing is you have an opportunity to then have an opinion. If you see somebody who looks like trouble, well, you're aware of them now. And probably they're aware that you're aware at that point. Making this a habit is how we learn to be more aware of our surrounding without being paranoid all the time. So again, this is something you can do right now. As you leave, you can say, I'm going to look for somebody wearing Adidas stripes. And eventually you can get more and more specific, someone with a mustache and eyeglass or something like that. Next time you're at the mall, try it. It's not just good for safety training, but it's good practice for your brain. It gets your brain a little bit stronger. Now, the next thing is, if let's say, for example, we are in a scary situation, or we're in a situation where we think we might get violent. Remember we talked about fight or flight being good choices, but if you cannot make the decision, if say you're on this road, and all of a sudden there's a roadblock, something is like a rolling towards you, and you have one street you can take, you have another street you can take. If you spend too long deciding what to do, that's when it's going to roll over. When we can't decide at that moment whether to run or to fight back, when we can't even make a decision, that's when you really become the victim. And that's what they look for. That's why surprise is a good thing, because when you're surprised, you're still trying to process what's happening and what they want. Maybe you have an idea, but you're still trying to maybe come to terms with the situation that you're in. You're trying to like even accept the reality of what's happening. By that time, it might be too late. You've given them that opportunity. Instead of surprise, you look, kick them, jab them in the eye, and then run away. That's another, you know, that's a quick response. So how do you make yourself able to think that way clearly? Because this is the good news about it. When we're in a panicked situation, you don't have enough room in your brain to think about everything. You can only focus on a few things at a time. Why is this good? Because if you train yourself to analyze the right way, you won't have enough room in your brain to think about how scared you are or how scary the situation is. You will have enough room in your head to either see where the exit is and make a run for it, or see where the targets are for you to attack and then make a run for it. So how do we do this? This is again something that you could start doing right now, and it's called visualization, and I'm sure you all understand what visualization means. Just imagine it in your head. So if, for example, you're in an elevator, or for example, you're walking and someone is walking by you, think to yourself, okay, if this person attacked me right away, what would be my first response? What would be the answer? It's little practices like this. Like say you're holding a pencil or holding a pen in your hand. Somebody's walking by and you look at, well, if she jumped at me, maybe this thing would be the first thing I have because I'm holding the pencil like I'm holding a knife. Maybe then I can go ahead and take my knee and then I'll run it right after that. I'm practicing this over and over. It again teaches your brain to kind of analyze, to interpret what's happening. And it eliminates that indecisive part of you where you don't know whether to run or to fight back. It eliminates that hesitation that you have. So it's called a couple of different things. You just call it scanning somebody or scanning the situation. It's technically called red zoning the situation. And the whole like red hat drill or looking for somebody with glasses, that's called yellow zone of awareness. But we don't have to learn all those things. So these are two things, two mental practices you can start right now that it won't just kind of make you more physically ready and mentally ready for combat. It'll literally, you'll literally kind of give out a vibe that you're not somebody who is an easy target. If you're walking around and it just, somebody is like, you know, sitting somewhere and they're thinking, okay, who should I follow home? Who looks like they might have some money in their bag or, you know, whatever their intention is. And they're looking for somebody who's, just not like in a scared way, but just casually already scanning just as a habit. Already they're gonna be like, okay, well, you know, she's gonna see me coming before I get close enough. Secondly, she looks like she's already, you know, knows how to be suspicious and discriminating and not overly nice or something like that. So understand one thing, not one thing, but I'll tell you all a quick story. One of my instructors, his wife, my martial arts instructors, so his wife had this story to tell. She picked her kids up from daycare, and then she took the kids to the mall with her because she needed to pick up some dry cleaning. And she parked in an underground parking lot. And she ended up, her and her kids ended up having to wait for a long time at the dry cleaner because something was wrong. And by the time that she left, it was already dark, and there were a lot of cars that had already left. And so she's walking with her two kids and the dry cleaning, and she's walking through this garage, this underground garage. And she noticed, just because she was taught to be aware, she noticed that about 30 feet behind her, or maybe 40 feet behind her, there was a man who was walking in the same direction behind them. Now, it could have easily been just a person walking to their car, and maybe it was. But what she did first, she stopped walking towards her car. She started walking, not because usually, and I know you all aren't really driving just yet, maybe some of you are, but usually the most vulnerable time that you have is when you're getting into or out of a vehicle. But just remember that for the future. But she's decided, okay, let me see if he's following me. So really quickly, she just made a rapid turn and started walking a different direction to see if he would make that same turn. And he did. He made the same turn. Now again, could have just been a coincidence. She wasn't going to wait for another check. So when she realized that, she put her kids down, she put her kids behind her, and she just stared at him like this. And he stopped, and he kind of looked at her, and he kind of got like an embarrassed look on his face, and he walked away. And then she quickly then went to her car, called her husband, drove away. Now, it could have been a guy walking to his car thinking, what is this crazy lady doing staring at me? Like, all right, I don't want any trouble, you psycho. But if the worst thing that happens to you is you embarrass yourself a little bit, so what? Now, we're talking about your safety, right? That's the more important thing. The predators out there, they will look for people who are too polite, too civilized to respond, too nice to respond about it. Not people who will actually say, no, I have a line that if you cross it, we're gonna have trouble. I'm gonna let you know that I'm aware. I'm gonna let you know that I'm not comfortable. Okay, because otherwise, it's kind of like a snowball effect. They have more and more maybe bravery. They have more and more motivation to just keep it going. So it would be a good time for you ladies to think right now, what are those lines for you? What is something that if this person crosses this line, we have problems, we have trouble. I'm at the very least gonna scream at them, gonna put my hands back, gonna tell them to back off, gonna scream for help, something. But you gotta decide ahead of time, what is that line? It could be maybe not like they're getting too close. Maybe it's somebody who says something inappropriate, right? Maybe you're having a conversation with a stranger, they're asking you what time it is, and the conversation starts to get inappropriate of some kind. You have to already decide, no, it's, oh, it's not. Stop right there, I don't want to hear another word you have to say, and say it loud enough to where other people can hear you. That also, that's a defense, that's a shield that you have. But it would be good if you decide that ahead of time. If you already, and just have a conversation with yourself. Look at yourself in the mirror for a while and think, okay, where are my limits? What am I not comfortable with? What do I not allow people to do to me or to say to me? Make a decision for yourself and then stand firm, because that's your right to. You're allowed to. But also, again, if we have that situation where maybe something might happen, something inappropriate, it might, you know, the conversation is becoming inappropriate or somebody's walking towards us, have it in your mind, red zoning, scanning this person, just in case. Okay, well, this person looks like they might come at me, so what is the closest target? Where is the exit? What weapons do I have on me? And it could be just a cell phone that you smash into the temple of their head or something like that. You can always buy a new phone, right? So easier said than done, right? You know, still, it's a bigger person. Maybe it's a stronger person. What if you decide to fight, but you really don't know? You hit them, and they get angry, and they push you once, and then you're unconscious, right? It's easier said than done. So let's talk about one thing. If you're somebody who's just never been really comfortable with fighting, you've never been like really aggressive, strong person, it's okay. Understand, you still have it in you. As animals, we are predators because our eyes are in the front of our head. Okay? If we're prey, eyes would be around here looking for the predators. Right? You have it in you to attack. We as a species have taken over the world because of our ability to be predators, to learn control through the use of tools, but still, actually I can't see the clock too well. I'm gonna check the time here quickly just to see what time it is. Okay. So if you want to do a quick kind of mental exercise, you don't have to close your eyes, but maybe it will help. And I want you to think that you're walking down the street. It's an empty street. There's nobody around. But you're with somebody who you really love, who you really care about. Maybe it's a little sister, maybe it's a mom, maybe it's a grandma, something like that. And in front of you steps a very strong, very scary, very big person, and they want to hurt that person you care about. They don't want to hurt you. They want to hurt the person that you care about. And I want you to visualize what would happen if they attacked that person you care about. And I want you to visualize what would happen if you did nothing to stop it. Now you can open your eyes. And if you felt a little angry, you felt a little jazzed up, understand, you've got that spark in you. We've all got that spark. And that spark does not go away for as long as you're alive. Now, if you want to make that spark into a fire, you can do that too. But that's something that you will always have. You will always have that fight in you. You just have to look for the right circumstances. And ladies usually are a lot more brave when they have to protect somebody else than protect themselves. But you understand that protecting yourself is protecting everybody who cares about you. It's protecting your family and friends who would be devastated if anything bad were to happen to you. So just keep that in mind. You've got that fight in you. Now let's do one more thing. Let's, again, if you want to close your eyes. So you're in a dark alley. And there's a person and they're running towards you. And you can see that they've got something in their right hand. And you think to yourself, this person's trying to kill me with this thing. I've got to defend myself. And they swing their right arm at you and you hold your left arm and you block that. You can open your eyes if you want to. Now that's the wrong way to look at it. That's a defensive mindset. Why? Because you're thinking, they won't hurt me. All you're thinking about is this. And your thinking stops after that. And what if it's this? Boom, 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 and eventually you're down. So just think at that moment, I want to protect myself, it's not enough. Now let's do the same situation, same motion, but you want to close your eyes. So you're in a dark alley, you see a person running towards you, they're holding something in their hand, and you think, this person's trying to kill me with this thing. I've got to take him out, I've got to put him down. And he swings the right arm at you, and you chop at his arm with your left forearm. And maybe you knock them off balance, maybe you knock it out of their hand. You can open your eyes if you want to. So the same situation, the same motion, right? They're swinging and you're reacting with your left arm. Different mindset, offensive mindset. Attack your attacker. Here's the advantage you have as ladies. If you hit them first, if you attack them first, and you attack them hard and you keep hitting them, if the police get involved, you can always say, you know what, I felt so scared and so threatened that I knew that if I was going to wait for them to attack me, my chances were going to be small, that I had to take the initiative. As a lady, you have a right to say that, and the police will believe you, for the most part. That'll happen. So
Don't wait. If you have an opportunity, you see it, or you know, you've got those lines saying, if this person says this, or they make a move, I know that I have the right to defend myself. Don't wait. So if they just take a step towards you, or if they say, I'm going to do this to you, or whatever else, that's it. Green light. Go. And then you can explain it. Or better yet, hurt them bad and then run away so you don't have to deal with it. But if it's a thing where you have to explain yourself later, you can always say, they crossed that line with me, and I wasn't going to wait for them to attack me. I know that whoever hits first usually wins. So I was going to wait for them to hit first. Right? Okay, now, all's well, you know, all's good if you can actually do it. What are some things we can learn right now? Does everybody stand up for a second? Spread out, and 2, 4, 6, 8. We have even number of people. Perfect. So just partner up with the person that's right next to you. So you two. You can come out a little bit if you want. So understand, it doesn't matter if you're right-handed, you don't have to stand with the right leg back. You just have 1 foot forward, 1 foot back. Because if I'm standing like this, somebody pulls me or pushes me, it's an off-balance thing. If I have 1 foot forward, 1 foot back, being pushed and pulled is a little bit easier. Technically, we're incorrect foundationally, structurally. We should have 3 legs. We should be tripods to walk, which is why it's very easy to off-balance a person who has 2 legs, which is the most. But keep this in mind here. Now, with whichever your lead hand, let's go ahead and spread out a little bit more. And one person in each pair, raise your hand, please. One person in each pair. So whoever is holding their hand out, you're not going to be moving. You're going to be standing still. So I just want you to stand like this. And can I ask you to help me, please, for a second? Raise your hand, please. Yes. So I don't want you to go fast, and I don't want you to actually touch the eyes. Please, be careful here. What I want you to do is reach out. I'm going to touch your forehead. I want you to reach out with your fingers, touch the forehead like that. Now, it doesn't seem like it's a big deal, but honestly, I can put you all against the wall, and I would say, okay, practice. Go, 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 go. You can practice the eye jab over and over and over, but it won't be as effective for your mind, for your mental, physical training. It won't be nearly as effective as if you reach out and make contact. Because now I don't have to wonder, well, I can do it on the wall, but can I do it on a real person? I know, even though I did it slowly, I did it carefully, I know. My brain knows, and now probably attack me from here, so I can jab them in the eyes. Okay, so what I want you all to do is practice with the closest hand. So not here, right? This, Talia is gonna see coming, by the way. This, whichever the lead hand is, that's the one that I want you to practice. I want you to practice it here. And maybe even here, turn like that. And if you want to practice with the other hand, practice it again. That's that forward. 1, 2, 3. Like that. Okay? Let's have one person do it a little bit, and then we'll have the other person do it, please. Carefully and slowly. And then go ahead and get started. I can walk around and correct you all a little bit. Slowly, please. And yeah, actually, touch the forehead for the eyebrows. Okay, now let's have the other person try it real quick. Slowly and carefully. Slowly and carefully. You can try it. Okay, stop for a second. Now, let's do one more thing. First of all, say if I'm attacking you, maybe you cannot reach my eyes, right? So understand that it's not always going to be the first attack, but understand it's an option. Even if they're on the floor, they're on top of you, you can still go for the eyes, right? You can still attack there. So just understand it's an option. But now, what's another thing that we can do right away? You kind of just did it right there. What up, Tommy? Can you help me out with that, please? So what I want you to do, and maybe you can just pick up your shoes just so you don't smudge your training partner's pants. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to attack per knee, whichever the closest knee is. But for the training purposes, just like we didn't actually touch the eyes, we touched the forehead, I don't want you to touch the knee. I want you to touch the lower thigh, right above the knee. So you can do two ways. With the lead foot here, just like lead hand, lead foot, like this. And if you look at my back foot, it's a little different, right? Watch the difference. It's not this. I'm coming up and then down with the arch. Why is this? First of all, it can be very strong. Bang, right there. But also, even if she's close to me, I can still attack that way, right? Like that. So, what I want you all to do now is practice. One, two, four. One, two. Or, boom, boom. So, if you want to kick, I jab, or I jab, kick. One or the other, like that. Okay, thank you. Let's give that a shot. One person can go, and then the other person can go. Good. Good. Okay, let's have the other person try it, please. Or you can keep switching back and forth, and that's what you've already been doing, but let's keep going for a little bit longer. You said till 120?
125.
Okay. Let's go. Okay, so good, you know, simple enough, right? Nothing too complicated. So now can you, even with these little tools now, when we talk about red zoning somebody, when we're in a situation where we can, you know, like if we're standing next to somebody and we do the mental exercise, okay, what if she attacked me? What if he attacked me? What could be my first, what could be my second? We already know that even with those little things we practice, you can just visualize. Hit, hit, right? Or hit, hit. Even as you're walking through the hallway, you're walking by somebody, okay, if they just jump at me, maybe when I get them in the eyes first and I kick them, or when I kick them first and I get them in the eyes. Practicing this right off the bat, I promise you, it's going to do a lot to program your brain so you can actually use it. Not just use it when you're, you could be my best student in the class. If you don't have it in you to do it, when it counts, it doesn't matter, right? We're here learning from the reality. So, this is something you can visualize right now. So this next thing, I want you to just practice on your own for now. Let's just pivot and pivot. Squish the bug, right? One, two. So you know Dracula, the vampire, he's got the cape. So what I want you to do is like the Dracula elbow. So basically, so this the hardest bone in our body is the heel. The second hardest, right here. So, if I hit the right elbow, like the cape, Dracula cape, I turn my right foot. I do the left elbow, left foot. I want you just practice doing this, like you're trying to touch the back of your hand to the back of your head. One, two, one, two, let's try it. One. Now let's go over it real quick. You know, we talked about how to stand in a fight. Here is not good enough, right? It's going to take too long for you to jab the eyes or to throw the elbow. But it doesn't mean you have to let them know you're going to fight them. This could be a fighting stance. This could be a fighting stance. Or this could be a fighting stance. Because even though you don't look like you're threatening, you have your hands available. So you can say, calm down, bang, right there, right? So we've got a couple of things now. We're done here, but we've got a couple of things now. You've got the elbows, which is close quarters, right? Let's do one more thing. Turn the foot, but instead of coming across, come up and press your thumb to the back of your shoulder. Here and here. One, two. And then maybe eventually you can go one, two, three, four, five, six. Just pivot, 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 and follow through. So we've got, it's like throwing a rock at somebody. That's what it feels like when you hit somebody with a rock. It's the heart bone in your body. So what did we learn really quickly? So as we can put your shoes back on, so as we learn here, first, don't be paranoid, but be aware, right? Be aware, as you're walking out here, look for somebody wearing a red t-shirt, or look for somebody with a mustache, look for somebody with glasses. Train your brain to, you know, assess, and then throw it away if it's not important to you. Start to visualize these exercises, and you could use, you just practiced it, right? You just actually practiced it, so you know you can at least visualize the same way. Visualize it. And then when you're at home, Even if it's up against the wall or something like that, just practice. Touch, 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 boom, bang, 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 bang. Practice that enough, remember, surprise, speed, right? Slow is smooth, smooth is fast, and then violence of action. Pour on the hurt until the threat is eliminated. You all did a very good job. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, ladies. Take care.